Well, morning, guys. I'm actually glad to see anybody at 10 a.m. here.
Good morning.
Very cool.
Okay, so, David, good to see you.
Frederick.
Good to see everybody here. Thank you for making it. So my name is Frederic Court. I am a founder of Felix Capital, venture capital firm. One of the privileges and the, probably the best part of our job is to work with entrepreneurs who have each their individual journeys. So today we're here to talk about David's journey, founder of Highsnobiety, which started almost 18 years ago, so 17 years ago.
A while ago, yeah.
So you were clearly a tiny kid then. So can you tell us about Highsnobiety? So maybe before we start, how many of you follow Highsnobiety on Instagram and all the channels? Okay, good.
Great. Maybe we can win a few more today. as you said, I started in 2005. I was studying business at the time. Was always really passionate about fashion and the lifestyle space, and was almost a little worried that I wouldn't manage to make my way into my passion in many ways. At the time, I started discovering blogging. It was kind of the early days, especially in Europe, in regards to blogging, and eventually got so hooked that I thought, okay, I'll give it a shot myself. And essentially, this new world opened up itself to me at the time, and it was a space that I guess we would call today streetwear. You know, it was sneaker culture, street fashion, largely informed by America and Japan, and I was just fascinated by the creativity and the entrepreneurial spirit of the founders and the creatives that were active in that space, and that were essentially reinventing fashion at the time. And I guess in retrospect, you can say those were the people, the brands, the products that were really ahead of culture in 2005.
Was actually streetwear a term at the time? Or?
It's funny. The term streetwear was, I think, always by the people within the space was always seen, as a bit of a negative, because they never wanted to be restrained by that definition. But yeah, it was certainly one way of describing it, and it was. I mean, again, we're talking about the early days of brands like Supreme, the early days of sneaker collecting, the early days of men's fashion, So a lot of things that I think are today normal, are multi-billion dollar businesses, are phenomenons. I mean, you're wearing sneakers, I'm wearing sneakers, my parents, grandparents, everybody, I mean, I think it's hard to comprehend how niche the topic was when I started in 2005. It was, and the world was also a different world, right? I mean, if you look back, we started 3 months before YouTube, right? So it was, and we unfortunately didn't become nearly as successful, but still, it was a completely different time, like there was no Instagram, there was no Twitter, Facebook was just kicking off, so also, how to build an audience was very different back then. So that coupled with the fact that I was also operating in a really big niche at the in a niche setting back then was quite interesting.
So what was the operating model? Because you were a student and you started.
I just started blogging, right? And surprisingly, in the matter of 6 to 12 months, I was getting inbound requests for advertising. And so so that's really how things kicked off, And I don't know, the first advertiser paid $50 a month, and the second advertiser paid $200 a month. And so step by step, the business, grew a little bit. The beauty is, and I always like to point that out, there was no pressure or expectation that it would ever become anything, right? It was me blogging. I mean, nobody believed in blogging. Nobody believed in men's fashion. Nobody believed in sneaker culture or streetwear. So it was a complete blank page, in essence.
So you created your own job. You never got a job elsewhere.
Absolutely. I created my own job. I created my own business model. So the business model, was primarily advertising in the first few years. And then over time, with the growth of social media, it quickly evolved into branded content. So that was kind of the big next wave. Then we went from focusing on branded content to, you know, advising the brands and supporting them on actually creating the content, right? Because we told them, yeah, your product is right for the audience, but your content is not right for the channel. So why don't you let us produce that content? And so suddenly we start building this creative agency structure behind our publishing in after a few years. And you know, and then it really became a business that constantly transformed. You know, it went from you know, doing production and creative work to then adding talent to the mix as well, to then adding experiences, because clients wanted now to not only do things digitally with us, but they also wanted to bring it into the real world. And so step by step, we really started working with these brands very much 360. And on the content side, you know, our focus became very much that intersection of street culture and luxury, right? That kind of became the one thing that you could really find on our channels from the early days. And again, something that was very unique at the time, right? Luxury brands didn't really want anything to do with sneakers or streetwear until they realized many years later that they're completely missing to market to a very important consumer.
So was there a plan for you, or did you kind of build it as the opportunities came?
I mean, the truth is there wasn't. So, you know, you kind of build it along the way. I think, you know, the very simple principle of, you know, promising our audience that we will always keep them ahead of the curve, and by definition, always covering and interacting with what's next in culture, really allowed us to constantly evolve our brand, our business, and what we were doing. And yeah.
And so we'll talk about the culture later, but no, you talk about the audience. So you had to follow your audience across multiple channels then, because initially they were coming to the blog. And then in what order did you do things? And maybe also for the audience, it would be good to have a few numbers on the scale of the audience and the type of models.
Yeah, I mean, I remember in 2005, I met my wife as well, and I had to explain to her what I was doing with this blog. And I was insanely proud to report to her that 2,000 people a day were coming to this blog, right? So that was quite funny in retrospect. So today, when we look at, you know, Highsnobiety being on, obviously still on .com, we have our own app, we have TikTok, we have Instagram, we've got Facebook and Twitter, and, you know, so we're reaching about 100 million people a month, right? So which shows, I think, on one hand, I think it shows two interesting things. One, how big a niche can be, because I would still, in a positive sense, describe our audience as a niche, mm-hmm. but a gigantic niche. And I think it also shows you that you can be really focused on a niche and still build a quite sizable business, right? You don't need to address the whole world. You don't, you know, you can be very specific in who you are as a brand and who you target, and you know, and be the one place to go for that specific audience. And in a day like today, in a world like today, where, you know, you reach the whole world through, you know, social media and a variety of channels, that's actually completely fine.
And so you started with content, but then you went into commerce. I mean, you're wearing a cap.
Highsnobiety. Yes.
So tell us about that journey from content to commerce. That's been like a major trend.
I mean, essentially, if you look at the business today, there's the editorial and the storytelling, which is still very much at the heart of everything that we do. And then we have the client services business, which is the one that we started building earlier. And then much more recently, which is one of the big reasons why I think the two of us started working together as well, we started going into commerce. And I think ultimately we saw the opportunity because, you know, we were speaking to millions of people that come to us for fashion discovery and fashion advice. And a lot of it had to do also with curating products for that audience, you know, what type of product they should be shopping, where they should be shopping. And so we thought, okay, why don't we kill the bridge, you know, and just bring it all over to our own platform and bring content and commerce. The opportunity that we saw in the market was bringing content and commerce significantly closer together and really embedding product in amazing storytelling like nobody had ever done before. And that's sort of the mission that we walked into the commerce space with, right? And then so we started in 2019 with commerce, So we launched a drop platform. So we, you know, dropped really exclusive products that we worked on with brands or that brands gave us exclusively. We built storytelling environments around these products to, you know, build a certain energy and heat around the product. And really, once again, first of all, transformed our business in an interesting way, but also built our own way of doing e-commerce. Right, because I think we were also aware at the time nobody needs just another retailer, and we felt like we had a quite unique take on the subject matter.
Because you were not only curating other people's products, just like you were curating stories, but you're also creating your own products.
But that's the journey. That's now the e-commerce journey of the last 3 years, right? Where we went from dropping other brands' products to collaborating with other brands on products, so where we become our own designer, our own curator, and even designing our own product, right? So you're wearing one of our sweaters today, I'm wearing one of our hats. So it's of course amazing also for me, you know, as an entrepreneur to see that, you know, we can now express ourselves in so many different ways. And the dream, quite frankly, and I almost only realized it a few years ago, but the dream from the beginning was to create a place where you can discover and shop what's next in culture in many ways. And that dream is now slowly coming together in a 360 way. And ultimately, Highsnobiety exists because of our obsession with brands and products. And so how amazing is it for us now to be able to create our own, right?
So how has it changed your way to work with brands by adding that other layer on top of the media?
So, I mean, if you look at the journey on our client services business, essentially, you know, I sort of mentioned, you know, it was a media business. That media business then transformed into a creative business. So we would essentially, you know, bring together content creation for our clients and the distribution of that content.
And then maybe can you give us one or two examples of brands you work with to make it more concrete?
I mean, you see quite a few things here also on the slides. So it's kind of a mixture of our own content for our own product line, but you also see content that we create. You know, here you see, for example, the Gucci Adidas campaign, or we worked on the Gucci The North Face campaign as well. Here you see one of our most recent NFT projects, where we dropped our first digital product. So we essentially, you know, do for brands everything from, you know, more simple digital content to full global campaign work. And I think what makes it unique, of course, is that we are not just another creative agency, but we're essentially a publisher that speaks to this audience 365 days a year, right? So we have a quite unique understanding of what the audience reacts to, what the audience is into, what tastemakers and talent the audience is following that we can build into our campaigns. So, you know, the insights that we can generate from the audience are rather unique and allow us to be a much more, you know, hands-on partner than your usual agency. Then what happened a few years ago, you know, much like other publishers, you tend to pitch all the time your ideas to brands or to media agencies. And we realized that it's not the most efficient way for us to work, because you cannot, you know, live and die by your ideas, right? Sometimes you have the best ideas, sometimes you don't. And so often we were giving away our ideas for free. And so we actually embarked on this really interesting insights and data journey about 5-6 years ago. And, you know, really started building an insights team to generate true consumer insights from our audience that we could then apply to the solutions for our clients. And we built a strategy team that would enter the conversation with the client much earlier than your usual media partner, right? So we would actually support brands in building their brand strategy, their collaboration strategy, their rejuvenation strategy, depending on what they were working on. And that actually completely changed the way how we work with brands. And it's a service that we call cultural consulting, because we're essentially supporting brands in becoming culturally credible for their audiences.
And you also talked about connecting to the cultural pioneers. So that would be a subset of your audience that are particularly hard to reach, but that will be more valuable for the brands.
Yeah, so essentially, to go back to that insights journey, so we started 5-6 years ago by defining our world. And we called that world new luxury. Because what we could see is that a young audience understands luxury very differently from how it was perceived in the past, right? So usually luxury is about craftsmanship and about price and about heritage. And suddenly you had this new young audience that was also very much into luxury, but they were more thinking about knowledge, about access, you know, an audience that would value a limited edition Air Jordan sneaker as much as a Louis Vuitton bag. You know, and I think that's, you know, our first white paper in that space around the world of new luxury, I think really opened everybody's eyes that, okay, wait a moment, there is a young consumer that can afford luxury products, but that understands luxury differently, and we're not speaking to that consumer whatsoever. Right? So that was sort of the big learning with new luxury. And then in the next phase, we wanted to define the consumer of this new luxury space, which you know, you just mentioned, which we then called the cultural pioneer. So and the cultural pioneer is kind of your coolest friend, cool friend, you know, like an early adopter, somebody that, you know, brings crucial heat to brands and products in the early phase when they enter the market. And it's people that have, you know, a significant social following. It's people that disproportionately recommend brands and products to their surrounding. And therefore, they have a lot of impact, and it's somebody that you really want to reach as a brand. And quite frankly, as a brand, no matter what brand you are, if you're a digital brand...
There will be people in the audience.
Absolutely.
Running starting companies or running a smaller emerging brand. So any tips or advice to reach that audience or to be more culturally relevant? Because that's very much a lever on the business.
Absolutely. And again, the beauty is because you have to imagine that for a long time, we were, of course, always like, oh, yeah, it's this cool magazine, it's this cool agency, but like, who really knows how impactful it is, you know? And so the beauty with our research became that we could really prove black and white that the brands that understand the cultural pioneer, the brands that market to that person, the brands that understand how to be culturally credible are actually growing 2 to 3 times as fast as the ones that don't, right? So that was black and white findings that we could, you know, present now to our brand partners. And so I guess after figuring out the person and how that person ticks, we then in the next step wanted to figure out, okay, how can we now create a roadmap that brands can follow to trigger that person, right? And that's where we kind of came to the terminology of cultural credibility, right? So what does it mean to be culturally credible? What does it mean for a brand to, you know, to mean something and to align with the values of your consumer in the end of the day, right? And so, and essentially we came up with this three-part, with these three cornerstones, so to speak, of cultural credibility, which are made of world building, right? So you need to create a world around your brand that allows the cultural pioneer to embed themselves in your world, right? So that they can access your brand through many different avenues, you know, that access can come through specific events, it can come through specific product collaborations, it can come through content, it can come through talent partnerships, many different ways. But you need, as a brand, you need to understand that you're not just a brand, you're not just a company or a business, but you're a universe, and you need to curate that universe. The second thing that we found was that you need to, in order to be culturally credible, you need to become an expert curator, right? So you need to understand that you're not the only brand that lives in the world of your consumer, right? So I don't know, if you're a Bottega Veneta and everything that you do is about quality and craftsmanship, then you probably speak to a client that also cares about the car they drive, they also care about the food that they eat, they also care about the travel that they do. So how can you curate a world around your brand where the values of these different spaces align? Mm-hmm. That's the second thing that that we really zoomed in on, because as a curator, you're essentially contributing to culture and you're not just taking, in a sense. And that's something that's, you know, really, really important to everything. And then last but not least is entertainment, which is, of course, all about inspiration, because the culture pioneer is all about constantly being inspired. The main reason being that they actually make their purchase choice while being inspired, right? If you look at the purchase journey of any consumer, you know, there's the inspiration phase, there's the research phase, the purchase, and then the post-purchase. So the culture pioneer actually decides to buy something when they're being inspired. it's a general trend that you also see across generations as generations get younger. So it's more present with Gen Z, it's more present with Generation Alpha. And so as a brand, you need to constantly inspire your consumer. And so the idea is, you know, the example that I always love to give is, you know, if a culture pioneer goes out and wants to buy a belt, right? You know, then ends up in a department store with 25 different luxury brands offering a belt. The decision to buy the Gucci belt is not made in that moment, but the decision was built over many, many months when Gucci hosted a special fashion show on the Sunset Boulevard, when Gucci launched a collaboration with Palace, when Gucci curated a young up-and-coming film festival. You know, so all that knowledge is sucked up by the consumer, and in the back of their minds, the choice to commit to that brand is being made. And when they then stand in front of the belt, the choice becomes very clear, and you choose the Gucci belt, in a sense, right? And so, in the end of the day, what you're trying to do by being culturally credible is you want to do exciting things as a brand, and you also want to do things that maybe live outside of your main field of focus. So what you need to do is you need to give a clear narrative to your consumers so that when you do things that are maybe not exactly what you usually do, they still see that it's you.
Yeah. I'm taking mental notes because, you know, also as an entrepreneur building a business and building a brand as an investor, there are many things we could do different. So I don't know, I'll go back and think more about it. Talking about, you know, venture capital and your journey, you started with, you know, bootstrapping your business for over a decade. What made you decide at some point to work with investors, raise money, and then maybe you can tell us about what happened after and the rest of the journey up to
today. In that sense, we probably had a bit of a unique journey, to your point, right? I mean, I think especially in an environment like here at Slush, you know, it's very, the usual path is, you know, you have an idea and either you raise money, you try to raise money directly, or a year or two into you raise money. So Highsnobiety had been around for 13 years when you approached me, or 12 years when you approached me, 13 years when we started working together.
LinkedIn message,
exactly,
actually.
Exactly. And so, you know, I have to be honest, I mean, I personally very enjoyed that I got to see both sides, you know, in a sense, because the first 10, 12 years of the business were just a normal business, you know, like you make money and you spend money, in a sense, you know, it's not that
in that order.
Yes, in that order. It's critical that it's that order, but you know, it's not like I was sitting there and thinking about raising or thinking about, you know, or thinking about bootstrapping. It was just I was just running this business, in a sense, and I think you know, 6-7 years into the business, I started realizing that there is actually no ceiling to the business, right? So it took me a little bit of time to realize that this doesn't have to be a blog, it doesn't have to be just a magazine, but it can be something that is actually significantly bigger. And, you know, that's also when we started growing the team much more substantially. And then, you know, in 2017, 18, when we also started talking, I think, you know, we were kind of arriving at this ceiling in regards to, we had grown the business almost 100% year over year for 3-4 years in a row. And we just couldn't keep up with that growth. And yet, at the same time, we were still seeing so much opportunity. And then, at the same time, we, of course, started thinking about, okay, do we want to go into e-commerce? You know, doesn't that make sense as part of our offering as well?
And that required capital to take
And that, of
risk.
Course, you know, required a completely different capital needs. It required different tech needs as well. You know, we needed to build a global e-commerce platform on Highsnobiety. So, you know, our tech team became significantly bigger. And so, so raising money at the time made sense, and it was, in retrospect, you know, a different but also equally amazing experience, because, you know, I got to meet you and many other great people and people that were constantly pushing us to think bigger, you know, and never, you know, to allow us to think that, you know, the growth that we were seeing right now was, you know, the end of it all. And so I think that's what venture capital did to us. And at the same time, I think because we had been a bootstrap business for so long, it also gave us maybe a bit more balance than you may see in other businesses, right? So we could appreciate the push from the outside, but we were also still valuing a certain stability in the business overall, right? And
And we just have a few less than a minute to finish. So, you know, a few words. Next thing for Highsnobiety. So now I'm part of the Zalando group, but running independently.
Well, I think the exciting thing is two things. One, we continue to operate completely independently. So, you know, we continue to build the vision that we had for our business 6 months ago is still the same today. And, you know, we're moving into increasingly women's, because 50% of our audience today is women's. With that, we're moving into beauty and into new fields. So that's really exciting. And then on the Zalando side, what's of course also very exciting is we have a seat at the table now at the biggest fashion retailer, e-commerce fashion retailer in Europe. And suddenly we get to apply all the learnings, all the things that I was just speaking about. You know, we get to apply new luxury, the cultural pioneer, cultural credibility, our consulting and creative muscle to this gigantic business, and we get to do it long term, right? So we really get to be, you know, one of the people that support the transformation now of Zalando, which is of course super exciting.
Well, thank you, David. I love to hear your long-term vision, and I can't wait to see what you do next. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thanks, guys.